you mentioned Hal Putoff, Kit Green, Richard Doty, and so on.
Yeah.
Why are, in your opinion, why are these same names seemingly appearing in all of these highly controversial stories? And why are we seeing kind of this recycling of stories from decades ago?
They actually started to appear in 1975 with Robert Emmenegger. So what they are, they're just like you and I, John, except they ran into the program at some point during their career. They may have been in part, like, for example, Kit Green. Kit Green, I was told, like 20 years ago, he was a physiologist. So he had UFO material from being at the CIA. He knew little bits and pieces of the story, but he wanted to get read in on the alien autopsy. That was what he was interested in, and he could never get read in on the alien autopsy. Couldn't. And Eric Davis told me that years ago. He couldn't get read in. And so what they are just people like you and I who have had security clearances, who have these contacts, so that you're in a job, and then you run up against other people who have high level security clearances. And so every time there's money or every time there's information, they go to the story. So Bob Emmenegger had this inside. He could go inside the Pentagon without signing in, you know, all this stuff. So they were all linking up to him. And they all, when the NIDS thing happened in the 2000s, Eric Davis was talking to me, and I know that they were after, for example, the Holloman Air Force Base story. They were, Hal Putoff and Eric Davis were trying to figure out the Holloman Air Force Base story. Is it true? They were going to bring in Shardle to talk to. They were doing this investigation and stuff. So they go there, and then along comes Bill Moore, and Bill Moore gets these high-level guys who come to him and say, you know, the only guy who knows who you're talking about, and he has these high-level contacts, and they suddenly realize there's all these people, and it was called, Ballet used to call it the Invisible College. Then it was called, Bill Moore called it the Avery. Now it's called the Cosmic Club. And Jim Semivan says there's at least 50 people in this thing. So there are people on the sidelines. So when Tom DeLonge comes along, and Tom DeLonge's got money and he's got power and stuff, everybody just sort of gravitates to go, oh, you see this? The government's talking to Tom DeLonge. Let's go see. There may be money. There may be information. So they gravitate. So they went from to the Avery for Bill Moore. Then when John Alexander had the Advanced Physics Theoretical Working Group with 20 people, they were all there because, oh, John's having this meeting. Let's go. Maybe we'll learn something. Maybe there'll be some money. Maybe there'll be some funding. So they go to that thing. Then along comes NIDS. So they all join NIDS because he's paying big time money. I heard, I won't say what it was, but these guys were being called in. The Avery guys were making huge per diems by Bob Bigelow. So they bring in and say, come on, Bob's got money. We're talking about these subjects. We're talking to these other people. And they used to call it the bird chatter. So they would have these, and I, at one point, I actually saw some of these emails. They would talk to themselves among each other because they were high level guys. I can trust you because you got a security clearance. You may know something I don't know. They're just at a higher level than you and I, and they're talking. So they went to the NIDS. Then when Joe Firmage came along and he had millions of dollars and he got into it, they all joined Joe Firmage's organization because he's got money and he may have information. And then when that folds and they go to the ASAP thing, they realize there's money there. Then Tom DeLonge comes along, they realize there's information and money there, and they just gravitate to wherever they think there's information or money.
Let me jump in and ask you, should I be reading into your quite frequent references to money? Is this?
Oh, that's the bottom line. Yeah,
I'm just surprised to hear you say it.
That's what I say is the bottom line to this whole TTSA thing. If you've followed Melinda Leslie, Jim Semivan is only talking to her. I knew this interview. I knew how the interview got set up. I knew she said, "What do you want to ask Jim Semivan?" I asked, "Is it constitutional? Is this something that you're actually running by government regulation, or are you guys a bunch of rogue guys who are violating the Constitution?" And he said, no, it's constitutional. The other thing I asked is, why is Ron Pandolfi denying you? So those are my two questions. But in the thing she said to him, she said, okay, Jim, when I talk to you, when it's on the record, it's all on the record. You tell me when it's off the record and I won't talk about it. Is that understood? He said, yeah. She says, what would really get you upset, Jim? What would stop you from talking to me ever again? And he said, mess with the money. She says, what do you mean? Don't mess with the money. And the whole deal was they're going to Congress. So the whole disclosure thing to me is what's happening now. My personal opinion, in order to get money from Congress, because they ran the whole operation with Joe Firmage, they were trying to get money. So they were going after guys like Charles Bombardier in Canada, a billionaire. They were going after this guy with this chicken place in the United States. They were going after Firmage, had a lot of money. And they were trying to finance this UFO research thing with using billionaires. And it didn't really work. So then suddenly Tom DeLonge comes along and they... So they decide, we're going after Fort Knox now. We're going after Congress because they got a $730 billion defense budget. Nobody's going to miss a couple of billion dollars. But in order to get the money from Congress, because if you go back to the Obama days, the big show in town was not Tom DeLonge, it was Leslie Kane. You read Leslie Kane's book, she said she was working with Podesta, and the big shtick then was, oh, it's going to interfere with commercial airline traffic. And I guess the Congress people went, get out of here, like, get, you're crazy. And it didn't go anywhere. So number one, so if you want the thing, you got to do the disclosure thing, because you're not going to get any money from Congress unless they believe there's actually a UFO phenomenon. So you do the whole thing, you do the disclosure thing, and then you turn it and you do the national security thing. This is a threat to national security. The Russians may get it, the Chinese may get it, and they're going after the money. So that's what Semivan said. She said, he said it four times. Don't mess with the money. They're going for funding from Congress, and everybody's going to walk out with a suitcase full of money. They're going to get the money because they can no longer get it from these billionaire guys. So they got it, and it looks like they're going to get the money. It looks like this thing is going to work. That's what Semivan said. Just don't mess with the money. I believe it's all about money out of Congress.
So is this money to line their pockets and have a retirement and they're greedy, or is this money because they genuinely have an interest in solving this mystery?
I don't know. I mean, I would say you've probably got various things. I mean, everybody's going to make some money because you take a look at the people that are in it. I mean, there's people with patents, with they're working on contractor things. I mean, they're all got vested interest in these sort of things. I'm hoping that they're going to do it just for UFO research, but you can see they're tying in Lockheed Skunk Works and all these different deals. But everybody's still going to be rich, even if you go through Lockheed Skunk Works. It may be honestly a program where they want white world funding into this kind of thing, but still, Tom DeLonge's a business guy. Tom DeLonge, his whole thing is telling stories. He's really not a UFO researcher. He's just a guy who says, I've got the lifetime rights for Bob Lazar's story. That's how he framed it like a year ago. I got the lifetime rights for Bob Lazar. It's all about money to him. He gets the Bob Lazar story, controls the Bob. And there was even a thing, and I was involved with someone who was involved in this with TTSA, this thing about the app. Did you hear about the app? They wanted to have this app where they're going to have the app where you phone in and this sort of thing. And you'd say, well, that's pretty good. You know, you phone in your UFO sighting or whatever, but then you end up in a situation where Tom DeLonge now controls all the UFO sighting. So if he happens to get a UFO sighting or a crash or something really spectacular, that's worth money. You cut into the thing and you get all the material coming to you. So Tom DeLonge would have a different interest than, I'm sure the Hal Putoff is 80 years old. I don't think Hal Putoff needs the money. I don't think Kit Green needs the money. I think they're honestly interested in trying to figure out whether it's Hal Putoff and the zero point energy thing, or whether it's Kit Green getting a briefing on the alien autopsy. They're interested. So there'd be different versions. But the thing is that there's $730 billion defense budget. So they're going to the intelligence and the appropriation and the Senate, the intelligence and armed services. They're not going to NASA. They're not going there because that's not where the money is. Their budget was cut. They're going where all the money is, in the defense budget. And that's what I believe is going on.